information in the search for a missing passenger plane, but still no closure for families. This is CNN Student News. There's little hope and a lot of grief for the families of 239 people. That was the number on board Malaysia Airlines Flight 370, which disappeared early Saturday morning. Word came out yesterday from Malaysia's government that somehow the plane's transponder was turned off. That's an instrument that transmits altitude, location, and direction. Malaysia's Air Force was still able to track the flight as it apparently turned and flew over the Strait of Malacca, hundreds of miles off course. Unfortunately, that's where the answers end. As of last night, there was still no sign of the plane. We can show you what it's like to search the area near the plane's last known location.
This is no easy task. This C-130 plane has been carrying out regular search and rescue missions since flight MH370 disappeared. It's the first time the Minister for Defence and Transportation and the Chief of Defence Force have been out to survey this massive operation. They invited CNN to join them.
I have to put this life jacket on because we're now descending to just 500 feet above sea level.
Flying low, the doors are opened for the search to begin. We flew past a number of ships scouring the sea for the plane, those on board, or any clues at all to what happened.
I just want to find the plane, you know, at all costs. And as long as that we are still standing and as long as people are out there praying for us, we will continue to persevere. And this is something that I will not stop. This is what I promised the families.
We flew to the Malacca Straits, to the west of Malaysia.
There are 16 ships surveying this area. That's more than 12,000 nautical square miles. They're joined in the air by 14 aircraft.
And that's just the area to the west of Malaysia. There are more than 30 aircraft and more than 40 ships in the entire operation. As we look out across this vast expanse of water, far into the horizon, holding his head in his hands, the minister tells me he's overwhelmed.
When you're looking for something in this wide sea, it's a reality check. Hard to find even a huge aircraft like a 777. But we must never, never give up hope.
What's next today? Their countries may be at odds politically, but cooperation is strong in the space program. After 5 months on the International Space Station, an American, a Russian, and a native of Crimea made it safely back to Earth together on Tuesday. There's no space shuttle program, so you might be wondering how they got here. Well, here we go. They got on board the Soyuz, a Russian space capsule, and rode it back toward Earth. The Soyuz has a shield that protects it from the heat of re-entering Earth's atmosphere. Once it's there, a small parachute deploys, slowing the capsule down, then a larger one slows it further. And about 2 seconds before touchdown, some engines fire, making the landing as soft as possible. NASA pays Russia's space agency to transport American astronauts to and from the space station. Each trip costs the U.S. $71 million. You might not be familiar with the name Tim Berners-Lee, but you probably can't imagine life without his invention. You used it to view this show. The World Wide Web appeared on the scene 25 years ago today, and it made accessing the internet a lot easier for untold numbers of people. But even in the mid-1990s, when there were some actual pages on it, they were sparse. Think black or gray text on a white background, maybe a couple low-resolution pictures. It was slow. Want to visit a web page? Be patient. It would load in a minute or two, or five. Even 6 years after the web was introduced, only 14% of American adults had internet access. Now it's more than 77% of all Americans.
Time for the shout out. Which of these has the most influence over your sleep cycle? If you think you know it, shout it out. Is it your respiratory system, circadian rhythm, sebaceous glands, or cerebellum? You've got 3 seconds. Go. The circadian rhythm is your 24-hour cycle of human activity, which includes sleeping and waking. That's your answer, and that's your shout out.
Of course, we all try to modify and master our circadian rhythm, but researchers say there's really not much we can do to change it. It's closely tied into the sun. When it's up, our bodies release hormones that make us more awake and alert. When it sets, hormones tell us it's time to start shutting down. But doctors say if you get too far off track from your natural circadian rhythm, it'll throw your body out of whack. It can increase your chances of getting sleep disorders, obesity, diabetes. It might even contribute to mental health issues. And as far as you students are concerned, some research has shown that those with unnaturally early start times, so figure those who have to be awake before the sun is up, don't do as well academically as those who start a little later. We love global news. We love global schools. Here are just a few of those watching in this Worldwide Wednesday roll call. First up, hello to the students of Ibaraki High School. They're watching from Osaka, Japan. Next, we're headed to Linz, Austria, the students of Borg Linz on Honauerstrasse. Glad to see you. And in the nation of Tanzania, we have some viewers at Ikorongo Secondary School. Thank you for watching in Mara. Palm oil is something you'll find in everything from crackers to microwave popcorn to shampoo. It is the most widely used vegetable oil on the planet. Mars Incorporated, the maker of Snickers, Skittles, Altoids, Lifesavers, Five Gum, says from here on out, it's only going to use palm oil that's obtained without hurting the environment. One way to do that is by planting oil palm trees and making sure that much of the palm oil they produce goes to good use. But there's another way to get the ingredient, one that's more harmful to the environment, one that involves deforestation. Why does that matter?
Deforestation is the practice of cutting down forests for various different reasons, but it's fundamentally cutting down trees and leaving behind a vast open wasteland. Deforestation is most common in countries like Brazil, Indonesia, and Mexico, Papua New Guinea, and Russia. The main causes of deforestation can be classified into three categories. Basically, industrial uses, chopping down the forest to build factories or to build residential areas. The second one is agriculture, so cutting down forests in order to grow, for example, palm oil plantations. Agricultural deforestation can also be caused by non-food crops, for example, pulp and paper plantations. And the third cause is livestock. So in many places, for example, in Brazil, deforestation is caused by farmers clearing the land to create pasture land for cows. Deforestation can happen on a lot of different scales. It can be anything from illegal squatting, a dozen folks in a local village using small rudimentary chainsaws and cutting down the trees. And then, of course, on the other end of the spectrum is massive industrial scale deforestation, where they bring in lots of heavy machinery, very advanced technology, and they can go in and clear forests in a very short amount of time. Deforestation affects the environment in two main ways. Trees, of course, absorb carbon dioxide, and as human beings put more and more carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, the more trees we cut down, the more we hinder the ability of the planet to balance how much carbon is in the atmosphere. But another impact of chopping down forests is, of course, reducing the habitat for animals to live in. Every year, over 1,000 different species go extinct around the world. That is a conservative estimate, and a big chunk of that happens because of deforestation.
Follow the leader. Boy and his bear. It sounds like some sappy children's story, but it seemed to play out in real life when a boy and a bear, who was much bigger, started imitating each other at a zoo. Not something we'd recommend anyone ever try without the glass. And we're not entirely sure the bear is just having fun instead of trying to catch lunch. But it's not every day the two get to play and no one gets hurt. I just don't think anyone could bear to watch that. Even what we just saw is just barely bear-eavable. They do seem to make a fine bear. No harm is brought to bear. There's no sign of beardom. But though it made for pawsome video, a clawsome encounter, the boy would have just been safer asking, what's Ursine? We'll have more tomorrow if you can bear it.